And how long is it before the gallery has to pay you? All that should be spelled out here. I mean, we spelled it out because it was a large quantity of things, but on individual things, in the consignment agreement, you should have in the consignment agreement that the money gets paid to you a certain time after the money comes to the dealer.
How do you know that the dealer got the money?
You don't. You have to monitor that. Or you put in the agreement, again, it's not foolproof, but you put in the agreement, you want an accounting, that's Sweden, because it was a large quantity, you want an accounting every month of what has sold. I mean, these things were all over the country, so the gallery that was representing them all over the country had to get this information every month. I mean, you know, it's a big thing for these galleries to be young.
I think one thing that's important for all of you to understand, because I know that the legal aspect and all this lawyerly can be very intimidating. You can feel that the contract has to be something that, you know, lawyers speak, and, you know, with all these clauses, but contracts are very simple. You know, the idea of what holds up the court is very simple. You have to name who the parties are. It has to be something that's called consideration, which is that I'm getting this for this kind of idea. And the terms of the contract are written out. It can be written out in the simplest of English. Really be just, this is what I want, just a series of emails given. I mean, it's amazing what can be really considered a contract. So don't feel that, you know, you need to hire an attorney or you need to go through a you know, major cost to create something. It is better to come to an attorney. It is better to get this kind of thing looked at by someone who's a professional. But don't feel that in a bind that you don't have any power. I mean, you really do. You can write down a very basic set of terms and agreements and both sign it and date it. And it's
yeah, I have something I give the clients, and welcome to it. I mean, I happen to have one here, and it's a checklist for distribution and licensing, which is something that I've created over the years. I mean, it makes my job a lot easier when somebody comes to me and wants something, and I don't have to sit there trying to extract information from them. I send them this, and I say, just write this stuff down for each one of these, well, 24 subjects.
Maybe I can get Stewart to put it on the website.
But you can do it on one, you can do it on one piece of paper. I mean, I had some people come to me the other day, and they said, well, maybe this agreement isn't effective because never notarized. I said, so it doesn't matter. And like you said, an agreement can be a series of emails back and forth. It can be a constructive agreement. There's all kinds of things called agreements. But the, yeah, there was a question.
When I sell a written payment to a client, on the back of the campaign, I always write all introduction rights user to the artist and the copyright, plus the input, obviously. But that gives me the and I was told by a lawyer, actually, that tells me that I can reproduce my work without telling the client. And so I don't think they want to know that they're going to reproduce your artwork if you choose to later on.
Be so, like doing lithographs.
Let's say I want to do a lithograph. Do I need to tell somebody ahead of time?
I don't think it would. As a matter of fact, it probably enhances the value of the painting. They know that there's lithographs out there that people want so much. They have the original.
Well, let's say 10 years down the road, they walk down the street and they're just, oh, there's my painting. And they're going to have a heart attack. Aren't they? I mean, would you want to see if you paint $5,000 for an original?
Yeah, okay, two more questions.
Okay, if you want to finish this.
Yes, I wanted to go back
may be able to take contractual action. I don't know, that it's probably a good guess. If you can't go to court, you can't go to court saying it's copyright, but maybe on a contractual basis, she could go to court and say they can't reproduce it because it says it. Then you can't do it if you're anyways.
No, that's what they said. You are allowed, you are me.
Why don't you file a copyright?
That's what it's a part of.
But is it copyright or not? Are you saying it's copyright or is it?
And they were able to use it just for the purposes they explained it to me. But if they want to reuse it, they'll have to.
Yeah, they made that, yeah.
They didn't do it.
We'll probably never check to see whether we.
I think you have a stronger contractual argument than you have a copyright argument. So you would say more when they could use it in the contract. Need permission to use it. Yeah, I don't think you can do that. The stronger claim you gave to contract breach than a copyright infringement, you know what I mean?
Yeah, wait, the minute.
There's two things going on.
You're making anything with your copyright.
You're making a contract saying, I have copyright over this. If you reuse this image, you need to get my permission. So now that you go and reuse the image without your permission, right? That's what you're saying. It's a better claim for you to say, you broke this contract and you wouldn't reuse the image without my permission than saying you infringed my copyright. Especially if you didn't have it. It's a breach of the contract. It's two legal arguments. So it's better for you saying you breached the contract because it's clearer. You know what I mean? That relationship is clearer. Yeah. Is there any more questions?
Any more questions?
Well, I just wanted to state something about the art contract.
Yeah, and then somebody had their hands up in the back. Wait, Becker.
I think it's important because, like, at first you're so concentrated on your art, you don't really get into the business aspect. You kind of get, like, forced into it. So, like, my biggest thing was this year, once we had a really good art battle, I sold most of my stuff. Well, the people paid me. They gave me my money. And they were from out of town, Switzerland. Well, now I've been holding the artwork for 6 months. I'm their storage because I didn't have that contract that stipulated, look, maybe you have the money if you don't pick it up. In 3 months, 4 months, the art goes back for sale. I keep the money, blah, blah, blah. Now I'm still stuck with the artwork. It's like, you know, when you're an artist, you keep creating. So you run out of space, you know?
By the way, just so you know, I have something here that maybe would be, I could send you, but it's, I asked my person in my office about copyright, and he sent this to me, and it's called Adoption of a Copyright, and then it says, in parentheses, copywritten 2006, what he sent me, and it says, all rights reserved, so I guess I'm going to have to call him if I want to give it to you to distribute, so then he probably copyrights everything when he gets up in the morning. When he had some breakfast. Alright, this is the last question.
You mentioned a little bit before the non-disclosure. You mentioned before the non-disclosure, but I'm wondering if you have a design for some work that actually has been fabricated yet, if you're shopping around for one great money, you might want to make it. What's the best way to protect yourself from that?
Start with a non-disclosure. Yeah, the problem with the non-disclosure, you have, a lot of times you'll have business will say, I'm going to introduce you to this person, and you have to sign a non-disclosure first. So, normally you have to put the person's name in the non-disclosure that you're going to introduce them to so they can sign it and say they're not going to go around you. So what if they get the non-disclosure, they look at it and they say, I don't want to sign this thing, and of course they go to it and they have to sign the non-disclosure. Those are the kind of things that you can involve in. You have to kind of dance around that. I'm going to introduce